I'm Dan Kloeffler in New York, and as the financial markets are closing on Wall Street for this Wednesday, December 3rd, this is Story Stock. Last month, the gold ETF, known as the GLD, celebrated its 10th anniversary as a publicly traded security. It's up over 150% since then. It has hit, though, some hard times since hitting a peak in September 2011, down nearly 35%, sliding nearly 5% in the last 3 months. So the question is why? Here, hopefully, with some answers, J.C. Barretts of Eagle Bay Capital. J.C., thanks for being with us. Gold, monster move a couple of years back, and it's now retreated. What's happening?
Yeah, we had a huge move after the bottom, 1999, 2000, 01. Really nice bottoming process after a huge decline. Bottomed out around $250, and over the next 10, 11, 12 years, really rallied up to over 1900. That was over a 650% move. And really that coincided, that bottom in gold at the turn of the century coincided with a top in the U.S. dollar. Because remember, precious metals are denominated in U.S. dollars. That was the key catalyst, in my opinion. And then what happened at the top in 2011 when all the metals peaked? The U.S. dollar bottomed and has really been rallying hard ever since, actually making new highs today. So that puts a lot of downside pressure in metals, absolutely.
A lot of pressure downside there. But so technically speaking, then what's next for gold from a trader's viewpoint?
Sure. So I think it's important to really define, you know, who you are as an investor. Are you a more tactical trader and more short-term oriented, or are you longer-term? And I think short-term, you know, really with the volatility that we've seen over the last week, I think perhaps a near-term bottom, you know, really might be in place. Maybe you got about 100 points to the upside, something like that. We do a lot of sentiment analysis, and right now, you know, we really are approaching historic extremes in terms of bearish sentiment. That could be one of the catalysts to kind of lift it up a little bit. But when you take a step back and you really look at precious metals from a structural standpoint, I don't see any evidence yet that a new structural bull market began last week. I just don't see it, particularly with the monster breakout that we're seeing in the dollar. I find it very hard to believe that we're going to get a sustained multi-year rally for precious metals, particularly gold. So I would stick to it a little bit more tactically for now.
Okay, so then, well, given that then, does it make sense then for investors to own gold via the GLD?
Sure. You know, the correlations are extremely positive. Obviously, it tries to mirror the action in gold itself. The expense ratio is very minimal. So for a retail investor out there, you know, if you want to have exposure in gold, owning GLD is very liquid, easy to buy and sell. So I don't know any better way to do it in terms of an investor going out there and buying gold, regardless of the vehicle that you want to use. In this case, we're talking about GLD. Again, structurally, I just don't see a historic bottom taking place last week. I think more time is necessary. And I think if you have a longer term view, you can be patient.
You're talking about metals. Palladium is oftentimes a very little known metal. What's going on with that right now?
Right. So when you talk about gold and silver, these are really precious metals. Palladium has more industrial uses and is really the best of the group without a doubt. I mean, just look year to date alone. Palladium's up 12% with all the precious metals down. Silver, I believe, is down 15% year to date. Gold is also down. Platinum is down as well, about 10-12%. So palladium by far and away when it comes to relative strength, definitely the best of breed. And take it back to 2012, you know, since the summer of 2012, you had a historic bottom, big time bottom in a lot of metals, a lot of currencies versus the dollar. Since then, you got gold down 25%, silver down 40%, palladium is up 40%. So you really want to look at palladium in terms, you want to be in any of the metals, that's the one. You know, we like to position ourselves in some cases where we're neutral, a particular market, you know, where you buy one and short another. Buying palladium and shorting silver against it continues to work. Last week hit 10-year highs in that ratio, where you are essentially for every dollar that of palladium that you're exposed in, you are short $1 of silver. That ratio continues to work, and I think it will continue to.
In shorting, essentially, just basically is saying that you believe that the price is going to drop when you own that commodity. I want to ask you lastly about copper, because that's the base metal that's oftentimes to the industrial production and really an overall economic movements. What have we seen for copper?
Sure. And, you know, we like to focus on really forward-looking markets, you know, the economy and the stock market. There's really no reliable correlation there. I would argue that the price of copper and the behavior there really moves with emerging markets, not necessarily U.S. stocks. So particularly the BRIC nations, Brazil, Russia, India, China, copper really moves hand in hand with those, and it's not a coincidence that both of them continue to struggle. Copper is just not a metal that we want to own. It continues to make new lows. Emerging markets continue to make new lows as well. So when you're looking at the market and the world as a group, when it comes to stocks, you really want to look at copper and emerging markets together. I think that's really the key indicator.
Keeping an eye on all things shiny, J.C. Peretz from Eagle Bay Capital. J.C., thanks so much. Have a good Wednesday.
Thanks for having me.
You've been watching Story Stock. Stay with ABCNews.com for your latest headlines. I'm Dan Kloeffler in New York.